We can also categorize cloud computing in public cloud, private cloud, and then hybrid cloud, where public cloud means that the service is available for everyone, paying of course. Private cloud or community cloud is a cloud environment set up for a certain organization or groups of organization, and hybrid cloud is a composition of the two aforementioned models. Sometimes also used for services combining on-premise, that means own supported or self-administrated software and hardware, and cloud services. Here are some examples of cloud computing. First of all, software as a service here, with prominent examples being Google and Doodle, Flickr, Office 365, and so on. Then here we have platform as a service. We have here Amazon, for instance, and they're also falling into infrastructure as a service because they're offering so many different services. But also here, Google Cloud Platform, and here as well. And infrastructure as a service, specifically, we have here Rackspace or Akamai. That's a screenshot of the web services Amazon is providing in their AWS infrastructure or platform. This is already a few years old. Perhaps some of the services are not available anymore. Maybe some came in addition. You see here, of course, EC2, the compute platform, so you can rent some machines. You can say, I want to have, let's say, one or multiple Ubuntu Linux machines in this version. The data you can store in the local disks, or also here in some dedicated storage infrastructures like S3. You can have databases like DynamoDB, as we discussed, and also here other tools like analytical infrastructure services like Elastic MapReduce, for instance. Related to cloud computing, but also different, is the traditional outsourcing of infrastructure or services. So you're making a contract with a certain provider, let's say some server provider where you want to put your website to. Perhaps some of you did this. Then you're making a contract, perhaps on a yearly basis, where you're renting a certain machine. That's of course similar, but not really the same as cloud computing. Here you talk about long-term static contracts about a certain amount of hardware. And if you want to change the infrastructure, you have to usually in manual interact with a service provider. You cannot really do this on your own, or maybe perhaps even using APIs like you can do, for instance, in Amazon's cloud computing infrastructure. Yeah, so this is like a big difference, but the idea, of course, is similar. So what do we need for cloud computing if you want to offer cloud computing as a service to customers? One ingredient is virtualization. So you're running virtual machines decoupled from hardware. That means you have a strong machine, let's say, and then you're starting virtual machines on these physical machines in case there is a demand coming in from a user. The other one is pervasive network access. So you have nowadays super fast bandwidth between machines in the compute center, and you have availability of mobile internet connections. And of course, if you're moving applications from your own company to the cloud, for instance, your word processing infrastructure, you have, let's say you acquired Microsoft Office and now you want to move it to the cloud, or you're working with Google Docs, of course, you always need to have internet access, right? So this is of course important or important enabling step towards cloud computing being successful. Web services, or in general service-oriented architecture. So we have some web-based APIs you can interact with applications through, and you can combine, of course, multiple of these services into your application how you would like to have it. And of course, last but not least, web technologies, simple things like HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and so on. So you can use these to work with other services and to build applications which are interesting and helpful for users. So let's have a look at these three illustrations. On the left side is customer 1, 2, and 3, and these have individual requirements on the system capacity. So here you have a huge peak, and this peak cannot even be served because it's exceeding the system capacity. And in the meantime, here you have unused, wasted resources in most of the time. And of course, it does not really make sense to buy or rent as many hardware or computing power to serve the peaks, because these can be really high. So provisioning for peaks is a wasting capacity. So if you're looking at all of these three illustrations here and you combine them in one, you see that the peaks are not happening at the same time. So a system or cloud provider can serve these individual customers, including, of course, the peaks as well, by providing less than the sum would indicate if you're looking at the individual system capabilities that are required, right? So this is like the important observation here. So we can benefit from the peaks being at different times. The idea behind this observation is statistical multiplexing. So let's say you have a system that has capacity C, and this is shared or used in a shared way by n identical tasks. And every task has the capacity requirement small c. So in principle now, you have the system requiring small c times n capacity, right? And only in the case where this is smaller or equal than c, the system can handle it, right? And it's even underloaded in this case. However, if you assumed you know that there are only 10% of the tasks are active, then it is okay, or it is enough, if C, the capacity of the entire system, is larger or equal than N times small c divided by 10, right? So you have an immense cost reduction here if you can make this assumption. And this is called statistical multiplexing gain. There are two types, spatial and temporal. Spatial would mean that we expect a fraction of tasks to be simultaneously active. And temporal means that we expect a task to be active only some part of the time. So consider a hotel with 100 rooms. How many external phone lines do you need? Well, 100 would be, of course, the answer if everyone is talking on the phone anytime. But this is not realistic, so you would make some assumptions in order to save money, because 100 external phone lines cost money for installing them and also for the contracts with the service provider. So how many are enough? So what happens if you know that a voice call is active only 40% of the time? Right? And that is why you need that call being processed only in 40% of the time. In this case, we can get spatial and temporal statistical multiplexing gain. However, here this is only possible if we have a packet switched network, right? So if you have someone talking on the phone and is silent 40% of the time, then of course this works only if it's voice over IP, let's say, and not like an old common phone where the connection would be used even if nobody's talking. In order to get this work and make everyone happy, so the hotel owner and also the customers, we need, of course, good statistics. And if the statistics are incorrect or change over time, we get trouble, right? So we get trouble with the hotel guests, and because they cannot take the phone. So if you have a hotel which is used by a lot of business people, perhaps they're using more the phone than if it's like a hotel in some skiing resort where people anyway are outside. And for instance, if you have a road system and you say, well, we have so many cars in the city and they're driving to the other city per day, there's so many cars exchanged, how many lanes should our highway have, right? This is another approach or another problem here where you need good statistics in order to not mess up. A few more words on the individual classes of services. Here we have infrastructure as a service, and as the name suggests, you rent infrastructure, compute infrastructure. Simply, you're renting hardware, like machines, but usually not really physical machines, but virtual machines. And if you're going, for instance, to Amazon EC2, you can select which operating system you want, which type and number of CPU you want, how much RAM and which kind of disk and how large the disk is and so on. And then you it will tell you how much this costs. And usually you pay by hour. Virtualization simply means that the operating system you're getting to work with is running on some other operating system, the so-called host operating system. Here, for instance, you have an illustration hardware, so the real hardware, the physical hardware, and then a so-called hypervisor component, for instance, VMware or Xen. And inside these hypervisors, we have then the operating system running over virtualized hardware. So the hardware that the operating system that you will work with sees is not real hardware, but virtualized. I guess all of you have used, perhaps even already here in the DDM class, a virtual machine that we provided, for instance, for MapReduce and Spark. This is exactly what's going on there, right? And if you have a strong machine, you can imagine that you can run very many VMs, then virtual machines, on this host platform. And then if someone wants to get a virtual machine, wants to pay for it, then you can just start one and give the user access to it. There are different variants of virtualization. Here, this is called type one. So you have the hardware, then the so-called hypervisor component, and then the individual operating systems, or you have here in type two, which is called hosted, the hardware, so the real hardware, and then an operating system, and inside the operating system, then these hypervisor with, again, operating systems. So in case of the hypervisor on the left side, the hypervisor runs on the hardware directly without any operating system. And on the right side, the hypervisor itself runs in an operating system, right? For instance, the right side, you can imagine it's your PC at home or laptop. So let's say you're running Windows there, and then you're installing VirtualBox, and inside VirtualBox, you're running then multiple different virtual machines. For instance, the one we gave you here in DDM. There's this concept of paravirtualization I want to briefly mention. That's quite interesting. If you have a guest operating system running in a virtual machine, then of course the hardware is only simulated. And this access of the guest OS on the simulated hardware can be expensive. So the hypervisor instead can provide an API that the guest operating system can call directly without making this way around using this simulated hardware. But in order to make this work, the guest operating system has to be changed, so the code has to be changed. And this benefit is, of course, that you have increased efficiency, almost near native performance. However, in order to do this, you have to have the code available, the operating system code available. So usually this is done for Linux, or available for Linux, because of this requirement that the hypervisor or the company providing this infrastructure has to rewrite parts of the operating system. I mentioned already there's Amazon EC2 as one example of a service where you can go and rent virtual machines. So you can configure your own, or you're picking predefined operating system images. You can choose then also the hardware, how much power this should have in terms of CPU, CPU cores, disk and RAM. And for disk or for storage, there are also different possibilities. You can have, you can use a so-called EBS, Elastic Block Storage, which is attached to EC2 instances. You can also get a physical hard disk. And finally, you also have the S3 so-called object store available. And if you're configuring this, then this will be accessible from your EC2 instance. Some years ago, we had in the course some vouchers, I think worth $100, you could use to play around with these. You just needed a credit card still. We don't have that now. and I think they're not offering this anymore to lectures. But if you have a credit card to register, and I still think they have some free amount of dollar to spend, just for the sake of trying it out to see that it's really interesting. I think you should try that, everyone, to go and configure such an instance and start it so you have your own server or own virtual machine inside the cloud running. This, is, I think, is a good experience to do once. But don't forget to shut it down, because if you forget to shut it down, it will run forever. And then in the end, you're getting a bill which is exceeding your free voucher, right? So they have to be a bit careful with this. There are often stories when people would forget to shut down, for instance, the MapReduce computation or the EC2 instance, and then you have to pay for that, unless you have a good story to tell and they believe you and annulate or cancel the bill. A few more words on Amazon S3. This S3 stands for Simple Storage Server. Here the store is organized in buckets. You can have objects up to several terabyte large, and the access is done using simple HTTP SOAP interfaces, and also offers BitTorrent for downloading. When you're putting data there inside the data center, the traffic is usually for free. But if you're going outside the data center, so you want to download from S3 to your local machine and upload, I guess, as well, then they charge you on the traffic, actually. There's also interesting data sets available, for instance, the Google Ngram corpus or the Million Song data set and so on, which are already available in S3. So you can write, for instance, MapReduce code and analyze these data sets, which are already placed in S3. You don't have to really care about uploading it to S3 before. Just some example pricing. The numbers are from 2017, July, here for the region EU. So Ireland here. Now there are also different places in the European Union. Other prices might differ. Also in US, of course, it's like a worldwide service what Amazon has now created. You see some numbers here. I don't want to really go into details. And here again, data transfer, upload and download. Upload is free. Download to EC2 in the same region is free. And also for download to different regions is not free. And if you go to the internet, so the wild, not inside Amazon, then you have to also pay, right? So it's always paying. This is like the business model, right? So when you decide to move your company IT infrastructure and services and applications to the cloud, of course you want to have also that these services work in a reliable way. For this purpose, there are so-called service level agreements. So from the perspective of clients, we want to get something promised, because otherwise we would not use the service, right? And also the service level agreements are important to understand the performance. So if you have, for instance, something like S3, and then Amazon promises that all the requests are handled in a certain amount of milliseconds, then you can also understand how your implementation of your system will behave if the system is getting data from S3, right? So predictability is a key. You want to know what's going on. And the service level agreements are kind of a contract between you and the cloud provider. For instance, you can have things like, in 99.99% of all requests, these were done within 300 milliseconds, right? So these are the typical ways quantifying the query response time. Also, throughput, for instance, you can write SLA for throughput, or availability, so mean time between failures, mean time to recovery and so on, error rate and so on. Here's an example from Amazon regarding S3. So here regarding the error rate, and here also the monthly uptime percentage. So this is a kind of a contract, right? You're agreeing on, and then you can perhaps get your money back or sue them if they're violating these service level agreements. Because in the end, if your company has a problem that was caused by a slower response time, let's say, And then, of course, this is the contract should make that clear that this does not really happen, right? Here's an example for SLAs at Microsoft. Here regarding, for instance, storage. So we guarantee that at least 99.9% of the time we will successfully process correctly formatted requests, of course, only blah, 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 right? And this like also here another one. So these are typical examples of these SLAs. Then there are higher level services beyond this infrastructure as a service, like as we mentioned already, platform as a service and software as a service. And these get more and more integrated in everyday applications, for instance, Amazon's Cloud Player, or also smartphones, like for instance, where you're storing your pictures from the smartphone, you can already upload them immediately when you take them to the cloud, or you can have your music streaming from the cloud and so on. There's of course also platform as a service. For instance, we have here the Google App Engine and others. These allow the deployment of application on top of the platform services. For instance, Apache Tomcat and so on for Java, JSP applications and others. Elastic MapReduce I mentioned already. So this is something offered by Amazon again. You can run Hadoop code in the cloud. A few clicks are only necessary. You're uploading the jar file and the data to S3. You tell where the jar file in the data is lying, and then Hadoop is running. You can say how many instances you want. And again, if you want to do this, make sure that in the end, you're closing all of the instances before you're getting a bill after some months, which would surprise you. In the end, of course, you're finding the results in S3 like you would find the results in the distributed file system in Hadoop. This one here is not really related to the aforementioned cloud computing services, but still it's relevant because here you're also buying or renting services. In this sense here, in this case here, you're renting human workers to do a task for you. And this is done, or this is proposed by Amazon under the name Mechanical Turk. But there are also different alternatives in the meantime, like Crowdflower and so on. And what you do here is to formulate small tasks that can be solved in an online way by workers around the world, and you're paying them if they solve the task. These tasks are called human intelligence tasks, HITs, and usually are very small tasks. And usually the payment is also only a few cents. For instance, you get, you show someone a text document and the Google keyword style query, and then you say, can you say if this document is a good match to the query, right? So you can create like relevance assessments this way, and you're paying, let's say, for every document in the query, let's say for a small document of some hundreds or maybe 1,000 words, you're paying maybe 20 cents for the evaluation, and then then the people accepting this task, they can earn the money. Of course, you also have some cheaters that would just say relevant or not relevant and so on. So they're not really useful. And this is like a problem for itself to find those cheaters. And there are some interesting proposals, for instance, called honeypot or trap questions. So you're asking questions where the answer is already known. And if someone is doing a few of these answers wrong, then you know that they were just randomly giving answers, and then you can also step back from paying them, actually. So one example of a hit is this one here. So this is what you would get as a task, as a human worker here in this case. So you see here a receipt from a supermarket, and you have to now read that because it's difficult to read, right? So it's difficult for the machine to do it automatically. And here now you have to assess if this image contains a real receipt or a faked one, or in addition, which items were bought here, right? And some other questions you have to answer. And then you're getting a reward if you're doing this. And if you're spending some hours and days maybe on these tasks, you can earn some money. I'm not sure it really pays off, but depending, of course, what is your job situation, then this might be one source of income here. Few more words on cloud computing regarding potential threats, because it sounds all too promising, right? You don't have to invest in hardware, you're buying what you need, and if you don't need it, you return it, and so on. So what about the threats? The first one is about privacy. So you data and the data of your customers is stored to a large extent, or entirely even, at the provider. That's one thing, right? And there are, of course, also solutions proposed regarding, for instance, German companies are not supposed to have the use cloud services which are storing the data in some countries which did not sign an agreement on how the data is kept in a privacy guaranteeing way. And then also there's the dependency on cloud providers. So you do not have physical control over the hardware. In case, let's say, some machine is crashing, you cannot just go to the server room and restart it. So you have to rely on that they're doing that job. Then, of course, if you have a cloud provider sitting in a different country, and then the government decides to shut down your website, which is hosted there because of some political issues, yeah, they will do it because they are forced to do it. Maybe even worse, if your cloud provider is forced to give the data, your data or the data of the customers, to the government in order to find some traitors, let's say. These are all like problems you have. You don't have under control really, unless you have some encryption, and you still have to, in this case, believe that they are doing everything they promise and so on. And of course, what happens if the data center breaks down? Where's your data? How can you get this? And so on. And also you're kind of bound to the provider. This is also called vendor lock-in. So when you're tailoring your solutions, so your application to, let's say, all of these fancy services Amazon provides, then it's difficult to switch away from that in case you're unhappy with Amazon, or Amazon is doing something which you do not agree on, let's say, regarding these concerns here. So you're really then relying on this, and it would be costly for you to redesign your application to work, for instance, with a different cloud provider like Microsoft. And regarding software as a service, as you probably experienced already in one or the other situation, you need to be constantly online. Right? If you want to work with a document in a browser, then you cannot really use the services in case the internet connection is not working anymore. So these are all potential threats. Regarding security and privacy, before you're using a cloud service, even a small one for like a simple task, you should ask yourself, is this allowed to do? From a sort of legal perspective, is it safe? And of course also if it's trustworthy. So for instance, if you have someone here in the university in a lecture telling you to use some Google software, then this might not be compliant with the regulations, which kind of services are allowed to be used here, right? There was also now a decision in, was getting noticed on in the newspaper or on TV, that the schools in Germany or Rheinland-Pfalz, they were using for some time Microsoft Teams apparently for online teaching, and starting in a few weeks or months, or maybe in the winter term, this is not anymore legal to do because of some issues they found out regarding privacy and security. Right? This is always something to consider. There's of course legal foundations in that matter. Here, regarding Germany, talking about commission data processing in German Auftragsdatenverarbeitung, maybe people have heard about this already. So there's a specification or some rules that say under which circumstances it is allowed to use such cloud providers or not. And then some of the cloud service providers have also made special arrangements that it is legal for German companies also to use these service providers. Yeah. So for instance, it says like data transfer only to countries with appropriate data security. And back then, I'm not sure this has changed now, I did not check this, but when I did the slide some years ago, this included all European Union countries, but for instance, not United States. And there's a so-called safe harbor agreement. So US companies can self-register and guarantee certain principles. And then these certified providers are generally accepted by German authorities as well, right? So this is like a really problematic situation or problematic field to see what is allowed if it's not maybe your private pictures that you have to decide yourself where to put them. But this data, maybe, let's say university is deciding to put all the student data to, I don't know, to Google Docs, let's say, right? These things are complicated. Yeah, so summary on cloud computing, which is also concluding then this course. We have seen some basic techniques and paradigms behind cloud computing. The ideas are already quite old or some days old. The concept is pay-as-you-go for infrastructure, platform, or software. This promises, of course, many things, and primarily you do not have to spend a lot of money when you're getting your business started. Also, when you have a business and it's running and it has some peak loads to be handled, then nicely the cloud computing platform will adapt to this. If you do not need this anymore, it will scale down. This is called elasticity. So you're only paying what you really need for, and you have little or no administrative cost running or paying an administrator that is handling hardware failures, for instance. It has, of course, multiple downsides, as mentioned, and really critical points to think about, particularly, of course, privacy and the control to your hardware or to the data basically running in hardware in different country, for instance, and, of course, also vendor lock-in, as I mentioned.